You're listening to the Partially Examined Life, a philosophy podcast by some guys who were at one point set on doing philosophy for a living, but then thought better of it. Our question for episode 39 is something like, does religion necessarily conflict with science? And we read Friedrich Schleiermacher's On Religion, Speeches to Its Cultured Despisers from 1799, with notes added in 1821. My name is Mark Lintonmeyer in Madison, Wisconsin.
And this is Wes Alwyn in Boston, Massachusetts.
And this is Daniel Horn in San Francisco.
And no Seth.
And no funny additions.
No. The inn is just the dead manifestation.
I figured.
Yeah. Of a richer inner life that was left unexpressed.
We don't want to be accreting habits or doctrines that are just going to cut to the heart of the show.
I figured that was a pregnant inn there.
Oh, this in-joke will be evident to the listeners by the end of the podcast. Listen to it on auto-repeat, I would say. We knew that Seth was not going to be able to make it tonight for scheduling reasons again. And so we asked Daniel, and Daniel picked the topic. So if you're wondering, Schleiermacher, who is that? Why would you? I have requested Foucault and Sartre on the website 20 times. Why aren't you doing those? Well, because it's Daniel's fault, but it's a good suggestion.
I will say in my half-assed defense that anyone who fancies themselves a fan of Heidegger, I think, will appreciate Schleiermacher's impact on religious phenomenology and hermeneutics later on. But we're not going to get into the hermeneutics part. So for what it's worth, if you guys really want to represent, you got to go back to the old school.
Well, and I noticed in my web searching that Schleiermacher is very well represented on religion sites and history of religion related kind of things. So he's, I guess, the father of liberal Protestantism. So even if you haven't heard of Schleiermacher, you have heard of his view. And in fact, he could have been talking to people right now.
Yeah, in fact, I think there's a book that responds to the New Atheists that uses the same subtitle.
I was just looking that up. Is God a Delusion? A Reply to Religion's Cultured Despisers.
Yeah.
By Eric Reitan. Or something like that.
Let's hope he lives up to the pretense of stealing a famous theologian subtitle.
Yeah, I'm not going to hold my breath.
I'm looking at the Amazon page for that right now, and one of the reviews of it, I think, is very telling in what it says about Schleiermacher. He really says this guy does the same thing that Schleiermacher did back then, which is to interpret religion in such an intellectual, fancy-pants way that, yes, religion will pass, will evade all of the arguments that the cultured despisers, that the new atheists would use against it, right? This kind of religion is compatible with science. This kind of religion is really, there's nothing you could object to about it at all. However, in doing so, he makes it not what almost anybody actually believes. At least this is the charge in this review on here.
Although Schleiermacher, right? And is that how you pronounce it?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, Schleiermacher is okay. The way to pronounce it. It's just fun trivia bit. Schleiermacher is apparently German for veil maker, which absolutely no relevance to this discussion, but to the extent.
Interesting. That criticism that you just voice marked is a criticism of natural religion. In a way, he's trying to steer between the very abstract natural religion and then the positive or revealed religion with its specific doctrines, you know, Christ died on the cross for our sins and so on and so forth.
Right.
So yeah, whether Schleiermacher succeeds in navigating that is a question, but someone who's making that critique would have to understand that he's cognizant of that kind of critique of natural religion, and in a way, he repeats that critique.
Just to pile on here on a guy I've never read, I worry that this author is falling into an unfair pattern. I don't know if unfair is the word, but a kind of a sad pattern of people feeling that they really need to do everything within their power to rebut the new atheists, and will just marshal every possible historical or philosophical argument that they can to do so. But as Wes pointed out, Schleiermacher was more subtle. He was actually navigating between the more highfalutin intellectualized religions of the day and out-and-out atheism. And so my guess is what's going on, at least in some of the books, I don't want to beat up on that particular one, but in books that I've seen, is that their real thesis is you don't have to be an idiot to believe in religion. And that wasn't Schleiermacher's agenda.
So, and when we say highfalutin religion, we're thinking of this abstract God who, I guess, is the cause of the existence of the world, a sort of Spinozan God, impersonal. And really, it doesn't matter what specific religion you have. It's sort of a more abstract philosophical unmoved mover concept. And that's the kind of thing that Mark is saying that no one actually believes in when they're... Most religious people, of course, are into a very particular form of revealed religion or positive religion.
Where you have certain doctrines...
that you adhere to, whether it's, you know, Islam or Christianity or anything else you want to choose. There's certain things that you believe which go way beyond the sort of abstract philosophical God concept.
Right. There was another philosopher I think Schleiermacher was referring to. I think his name rhymes with want or something.
You're not allowed to mention him.
I'm hoping one of the three of us will have some opinions on that guy as well, so that see if that will play into our discussion today.
I should say an official part of the reading assignment today, as well as this Schleiermacher text, was at least the preface to Kant's Religion Within the Bounds of Bare Reason. So that is one of the things that Schleiermacher is responding to. So not only is he trying to show that religion is independent of science, but religion is independent of ethics, which is not something that...
You might expect him to argue that, you know.
The argument is not cast in the same way now as it was back then.
Right. But the point being then that Schleiermacher was responding to what we might call natural religions, which were either the deistic faiths of the day, which might be represented by people like Locke or Voltaire, people who looked to the natural world and tried to integrate scientific understanding and harmonize that with religious belief. And as you guys mentioned, making religious belief more and more abstract. But of course, Kant took a different turn, right? I mean, not only was he well-grounded in science, but he also tried to ground religion, not so much by harmonizing it in the physical world, but by approaching it through ethics. And Schleiermacher, while he greatly respected Kant, and I think found great value in Kant's views on ethics, didn't want to see ethics as the way by which one gains faith. And I may be, and Wes, I apologize if I'm mischaracterizing or oversimplifying what Kant is doing, but it seems as though that's the route Kant is taking to faith, and Schleiermacher doesn't feel that that really works.
Before we disappear into Kant for 10 minutes or whatever it's going to be, so what's so highfalutin about Schleiermacher is not that he has this belief in an impersonal Spinozan or deist God necessarily, but that he thinks religion is non-cognitive, that it doesn't involve beliefs, religion proper, right? There are things sort of associated with religion that are not religion proper. So what makes you a Catholic or a Protestant or a Jew? And those are all legitimate ways, which we'll get to how he thinks you can get actual everyday religions out of this in the course of this. But religion proper is just this inner feeling of some sort. And yes, you have to try to articulate it some way. You're going to definitely be driven to articulate it. You're going to want to shout it from the rooftops. And that's how you inspire others. And they can see, maybe have some similar experiences. It's very much like an artistic practice, he seems to think.
Yeah, it's a good way to put it. Yeah. I don't know if I'd want to call it a phenomenological practice, but it's a sort of proto-phenomenology that he's developing.
Well, introspective. Yes. You will get the point of religion, maybe, if you have a certain sort of self-reflection. And it's not like phenomenology where everybody can just sit back and I'm contemplating the essence of the table in front of me, or, you know, like Husserl does, because it's very hard to get yourself to have this kind of inspiration. But he thinks if you look around and it's very, you know, once you have a glimmer of piety within you, and this sounds very Nietzschean to me, that maybe it's just a matter of your constitution. Like some people are just too weak souled to have this experience. But yeah. If you've got it, then you can talk about it and communicate with others and reflect upon yourself and increase it and sort of see it revealed in different ways. So then you start seeing the world through pious eyes. And this makes your life all the more rich and gets you to understand even more what religion is about. And so that's sort of what religious education is about, is talking to other people and trying to get them to encounter that within themselves.
Yeah, there's a section in the middle of the second address where he really describes, I think, almost in the way that later phenomenologists did, this kind of opening up of your eyes, letting all of the universe come within you. And before your cognitive senses can separate subject from object, he says that's the magic moment in which, if you are sensitive enough, and I think that's the way you phrased it, right, Mark? You know, only certain people are going to have that kind of sensitivity. It's not that they have to be smart enough. They have to be sensitive enough to be able to just notice that magic moment before subject separates from object, as you presumably just sort of open your eyes and let the universe flood in. He describes nature, I think, and natural beauty as a way in which you're more likely to encounter that experience. And I think he described Jesus as sort of having the ultimate God consciousness, right? He was the one who was most able to capture that moment and become aware of his merger into the infinite, which I think most of us would have a very hard time doing. But perhaps phenomenology is a way to visualize how that happens.
I'm glad you brought Jesus up there, because that's sort of where religious tradition comes in. All authentic revelation And he seems to be pretty charitable, at least on the face of it, in what he considers to be authentic. Like, well, if people have been inspired by it, it was probably authentic. You can't fake it. So while even some parts of, and he doesn't go into this in here, about which parts of the Bible are, that's where the whole hermeneutic thing comes in, that he has a whole other works where he does biblical analysis. And I was noticing he has notes to the fourth speech that some of it, the Bible is just historical, but some of it, like the speeches, the
Sermon on the Mount, that type of thing.
Yes. Yeah. Are really what it's all about, where you can really see the inspiration taking place. And so Hinduism and Buddhism and all these things are founded on inspirations.
Right.
And these are all, it's just a legitimate part of human psychology and our being in the world. To throw Heideggerism in there.
I think what Heidegger liked about it is that Heidegger was all about mood and emotion and feeling and intuition. Well, actually, let me take that back. It's probably a good thing for me. Seth isn't here to smack me upside the head for saying it that way. But you get a strong sense in Being in Time of the importance that Heidegger attaches to directing your intentionality toward moods or toward wants, toward desires, toward these kinds of non-cognitive, preconceptual notions. And I think that's what he picked up on with Schleiermacher. Now, why does that matter? I mean, have we gotten too far into the weeds without summarizing what is the project here? Who is he talking to? What's going on? Or
I think in the course of our stumbling around, we've given a quick summary.
Okay.
Did one of you want to do a quick bio?
Whoever's ready.
Let's see how quickly I can do this. What's Schleiermacher's deal? He was essentially a contemporary of Hegel. He was born in 1768 in what's now modern-day Poland. He was the son of a Prussian army chaplain. He was educated by this kind of freaky pietistic community called the Moravian Church, which emphasized a kind of heart religion, an emotional religion. It wasn't really based as much upon text or scriptural authority as much as it was feeling the passion of Christ's sufferings and trying to access religious faith through that. And I think that very much influenced his later sense, because he seemed to merge that pietistic emotional heart religion with Spinozism, ultimately, to create this emotional attachment to an immanent God.
Well, also, he was a Lutheran preacher, ultimately. And I mean, that was the whole main difference between Protestantism and Catholicism, right? Is your personal relationship with God is what matters. It's the introspective individual de-emphasizing the political power of the clergy in favor of something more egalitarian anyway. So,
yes,
you know, you could see that that sect and Schleiermacher's eventual view is just specialized versions of this. And one of the lectures I was listening to in this was emphasizing his connections to Luther in particular.
Mm. Interesting, yes. So he's set up to take up the life of clergy at a very young age. And you get the sense, this is something I picked up from one of the lectures, you get the sense that being a clergyman back then was a lot like being a lawyer. It's just a profession you undertake. You study for it, you pass your exams, and you can get into something like a lucrative position in society by getting some sort of a tenured job within a church, preferably one of the state-run churches. What was interesting about Schleiermacher is that upon his graduation, he, through certain connections he'd made at the University of Halle in Germany, had served as a tutor to the aristocracy immediately after graduation from about the ages of 22 to 25. After 25, he passes yet another theological exam, which frankly kind of sound at the time like they're like medical boards. You kind of take these increasing ranks of theological certifications in order to be able to teach it to different churches. By the time he turns 28, he is able to become a hospital chaplain in a very major hospital in Berlin. And at that time, he starts to join the intellectual and cultural elite within Berlin. Literary figures like the poet Novalis, the Schlegel brothers. And at this point, he's really becoming part of the Romantic movement within Germany. And the Romantic movement was essentially a counter-Enlightenment. It was an emphasis of the individual against the state and authority. The whole aesthetic movement tended to emphasize feeling over abstract science and philosophy. And he became very much a part of this. But a lot of the intellectual and cultural elite he was hanging out with really were somewhat bemused by his Christianity. You know, how is it that you seem to be able to hang out with us and have these very enlightened views and yet still be as devout as you are? And he wrote On Religion in 1799 at the age of about 30 or 31 in response to his contemporaries that he was calling the cultured despisers. So these were people that were either part of the aristocracy or part of the bourgeoisie at the time, very highly educated, sharing ideas on politics and philosophy and science in these salons of extremely rich people, which raises the very obvious question, what the hell happened to rich people? how is it that we went from rich people getting together in the salons of the aristocracy into showing up on reality television? I just don't know how these cultural trends wound up falling apart. But in any event, this is what prompted him to write on religion. At the time, this wasn't any sort of academic dissertation. And I think you guys would agree, as you read it, it doesn't read like any type of methodological academic treatise. He writes this really as a literary work, because at the time he was really engaging more in literary activities aside from his hospital chaplaincy. He was editing a literary magazine with the Schlegels, who were a couple of instrumental literary figures from the Romantic period.
They're not J.R.R. Tolkien characters.
They are not. That's right. They were not related to Ori or Nori. In any event, after he wrote that in 1799, that really helped made his reputation. He wrote it anonymously because I think some of his benefactors had really resented what they took as an unduly bohemian take on religion, because a lot of what he was doing was mocking and criticizing positive religion, as Wes had mentioned earlier. But based upon that, he's able to, in a few years, he helps form the University of Berlin with a number of other of the movers and shakers of the day, and he's quickly appointed to be professor of theology. He then goes on and becomes more mature and somewhat sells out, and he backs away from a lot of the, I think, really bold claims he'd made in the work we're discussing today.
That's why this is so fun, because...
Yeah.
So the 1821 version, which is the version we're looking at, I guess he did do a little bit of tweaking of the actual wording of the text, but mostly he just added at the end of each of the speeches these...
footnotes, would you say?
These footnotes, yes, yes. Like, I know I said, it sounds like I said on page 9 that I don't believe in a personal God, but of course I believe in a personal God. Come on.
Right, exactly. Yes. I know I said that Spinoza really had the answers, but that doesn't mean I was a Spinozist. Right.
So it's like he's trying to save his reputation. But at the same time, he does defend some of the claims. You know, it doesn't seem like he's actually trying to change his mind. He's just trying to get you to reinterpret it. And in fact, what he's giving us is a peek of the second half of the project, which is, like we're saying, you know, if religion is ultimately a matter of this personal experience, but at the same time, it has to be communicated and it has to play itself out in certain historical ways. And so that means that he can be a pluralist. You know, Protestantism and Catholicism and these other things can all be legitimate outgrowths of, well, at least what was originally inspiration. Maybe there's some corruption and deadwood floating in each of them. I guess based on that, the amount of deadwood, he's going to be able to give an argument for why his version of Lutheranism is better than some. You know, having the idea of Jesus as a mediator between us and the divine, that works really well compared to some of the resources that these other religions have at their disposal.
Well, that's true, although wouldn't I? You know, I got the sense, probably more perhaps from the secondary authorities I'd read on this, that he's really saying that all religions, even Islam, even Hinduism, even ancient Greece, the ancient Greek pagans, had an access to a religious feeling and a religious experience that was really no worse. Yeah. Than what Christianity had on offer. In other words, it seemed to him that it was this imminent feeling that one could get access to that was the most important aspect of religion, and not so much Christian dogma as such. You're right. I think he does make some sort of – he's not very consistent. I don't think he's very rigorous, because he does have some other areas in which he sort of trounces on Judaism. But even then, he has a great respect for Judaism, and obviously particularly Spinoza. For 1799, I thought that was a very impressive move to make. He's trying to take a great step back from defending Christianity and really getting into the idea of defending religion as a concept, any religion. Let me try to see if I can break down what I think are the two oppositions that are presented within the two speeches we're going to discuss today. One is, in the first speech, he's talking about how do we reconcile the opposing aspects of human existence. Different types of religion, and even atheism, he felt, spoke to two different human needs. One is the need for particularity, and one is the need for universality. Particularity tends to be represented in what you can get from religion or beliefs that you hold. It tends to be representative by positive religions, such as traditional church dogmatics. It's represented by affirmative belief and positive belief. And even, he said, to the cultural despisers of religion, even atheism, because ultimately atheism is itself a form of positive belief, according to him, which is something similar to a critique you might hear nowadays leveled against some of the new atheists, that they're really taking atheism to something beyond uncertainty and into more of its own dogmatism. So he says that's one problem that people are having and that people need to reconcile. The other one is universality. And this is represented by the deism that was popular in the day, the Kantianism, who'd had an enormous impact on religious belief amongst the educated classes at the time, natural religion, and just critical reflection, the emerging growth of the sciences. This is a period of time in Europe in which theology was really becoming supplanted by natural science and philosophy. And I think we take all of that for granted today because religion has ultimately become marginalized. But at the time, it was still a very much a live issue. And Schleiermacher, in the first first speech is really trying to figure out how is it that we can mediate between those two human needs, those two ontological forces that are bearing down on people.
Well, I like that you're putting it as ontological forces, because that was something that stood out here, and it sounded very much like what we were just reading in Hegel.
Yes.
That he describes nature as a never-ending play of opposing forces. This is near the beginning of the speech. Everything has its determinate existence by uniting and holding fast in a special way the opposing forces of nature. Wherefore, the spirit also, insofar as it manifests itself in a finite life, must be subject to the same law. The human soul, as shown by its passing actions and its inward characteristics, has its existence chiefly in two opposing impulses. One strives to establish itself as an individual. The other, again, is the dread fear to stand alone over against the whole, the longing to surrender oneself and be absorbed in greater, to be taken hold of and determined. So it's not even just a matter of human psychology. That's just how ontology works. And I think he does have some positive things to say about the nature of God that's just sort of given by piety in the same way. I don't know. I don't want to draw too close a connection, but remember Spinoza's argument for the existence of God, if you go back to our podcast episode on that, was really pretty obvious. I mean, he gave it a couple different formulations, but one of them was essentially just, hey, look at this, any finite thing. It implies, sort of as its opposite, the rest of existence.
Right.
So there is an infinite. The world is this infinite. It is implied by every single individuation of anything. So it's sort of the world is given phenomenologically as the infinite. And that's almost all you need for piety and for a notion of, obviously, that's not enough for a God as a personality.
Well, that's what you have to throw away, right? That's what you lose if you go down that road.
He thinks it's dangerous.
Right.
There's useful parts to thinking of it that way, to sort of get people in the spirit and understand meaning and get some of what you're supposed to get out of religion. But it's ultimately not, right? He talks about the piety that this whole thing is based on as a taste for the infinite.
That's right.
We should say more what piety is, right? That the sort of awareness of one's own complete dependence on God. I think that's the fundamental definition he gives, right?
That's the one that he gives, right. It's in his later systematic theology that he actually uses that kind of phrasing, that ultimate.
Yeah, I know. I'm taking this from secondary.
No, it's okay. Believe me, that's what informs most of me on this. But in On Religion, which is, again, sort of a young person's work, and I think it has a lot of table pounding in it, which I quite take to. It's very much of the romantic moment, I think. And I think that the romantic literary style really permeates this, which I was curious if you guys found that frustrating, because there's really no rigor or methodology in this argument. But there's a lot of good emotional turns of phrase in some of this.
I found myself highlighting quite a lot of individual sentences, especially in the first speech here. It was using very poetic language, but it does just kind of go on and on and on, like this discussion, in a semi-organized way.
Right.
I found it very difficult to get through.
I definitely think so, too. However, I kind of kept going, and I slogged my way through some of the third speech and the fourth speech, not the notes on it, but just the speeches themselves. By the end of it, I felt like, okay, I understand where he's coming from. He just nips around and touches at it. And then when I looked back at the beginning parts, and I'm like, oh, all right, well, so it's almost exemplifying his own theory that he has this inspiration for this idea, the stance he's arguing from, and he doesn't know quite how to express it. And so he expresses it in several different ways. And it's not a cogent logical argument.
Didn't he also make a specific reference to that in the second speech of saying, look, in order to describe it, you're going to lose it. The whole purpose of the second speech is then he's getting away from, okay, what is this human ontological need? What is religion, right? How does one approach that concept? And he goes on to say that a lot of people think of religion as either something that you think about or it's something that you do, right? It's either a conceptual logic about the universe and about God, or it's a way of acting, such as Kant would have you do. It's a moral action. Whereas he's saying, no, there's this third realm. You don't mediate those two problems by finding a compromise in the middle. There's this third realm that you access of religious experience, which is this kind of feeling of emotion, this intuitive sense. But because it's intuitive and because it's emotional and because he's tried to describe it as this pre-conceptual phenomenological merger with the infinite, you can't properly describe it. Mark, in particular, you had some critique about that, which I think we probably ought to get into.
I saw a lot of parallels between this and our Taoism discussion
right. Long
ago.
Thank God you said that, because I wanted to get into that. Yeah.
Yeah, where what is most important can't be expressed.
Right.
But at the same time, as for Taoism, I'm just thinking back, there's a lot of description of people who are very spiritual and how they act.
Yes.
And they're very at one with themselves. They're very relaxed. They can do amazing feats of physical prowess because they're so focused on what they're doing and in the moment. I think Schleiermacher is going to agree with quite a lot of that description. Even though piety is just an emotion, it doesn't tell you any facts. It doesn't tell you there is a God and he loves me or something like that. If you interpret it literally, like there's a creature out there who has something that I understand to be this emotion. It's not something that literal. And it's also not telling me directly, don't kill, because that's wrong. If you're going to know that kind of knowledge, you have to get it from elsewhere.
Well, and the important thing there is that ethics doesn't come from religion. Ethics stands on its
exactly.
own. Ethics,
exactly.
In fact, he says religion is demeaned by trying to use it as just a useful way to get ethics. He says it's not only unnecessary for ethics, but it really cheapens religion to feel like you need it to support ethics. Ethics stands on its own. And I think, as we've seen before, Kant was so instrumental and so influential at the time, I think he really felt that almost all major ways to get through ethics could be gotten through Kantian analysis.
Right. In other words, reason itself tells you,
right,
if you're doing a Kantian analysis of reason, what you're supposed to believe ethically.
A practical reason, right, yeah.
Yes, practical reason. And that's enough. And the difference, just to follow this through and give the very short version of the Kant, and I don't know if I got a whole lot more out of reading the preface to The Religion Within the Bounds of Bare Reason than I had already understood from the Critique of Pure Reason before, right, from his epistemological works. I did skim the work itself, the first couple sections of that, and found it to be pretty interesting if you want to know more about Kant's ethics. Like, there's all these questions when we were doing the ethics. Kant seems to tell you, here's what you do. Here's the maxim that makes an action right. And there's criticisms that, well, it doesn't sound like he's much of a virtue ethicist, right? It's all just a matter of analyzing the action and your motive for doing the action. But in this work, Religion Within the Bounds of Bare Reason, he does seem to focus a lot on being a good person overall or being an evil person overall. That's what he's considering in here. The titles of the books in here, Concerning the Indwelling of the Evil Principle with the Good, or On the Radical Evil in Human Nature, and then Concerning the Conflict of the Good with the Evil Principle for Sovereignty Over Man. So he's letting himself use the language of virtue ethics while still really completely keeping to his own theory. And then the other foray is, of course, adding the God language to this. And in some ways, it's kind of metaphorical. And so again, I'm not feeling like I got a lot more additional information out of looking at this, but I did get some examples of the way Kant thinks you can use religious speech. So pretty much his argument for, it's an indirect argument, right? You can't have a direct argument for the existence of God because, by definition, that's beyond the bounds of human understanding, right? Human understanding only judges things that are in perception or truths of logic, things like that, right?
Yes.
So if you're doing old-style metaphysics and trying to prove things about God, you're violating that. And the same thing, if you try to use old-style metaphysics and say, yeah, God came up with these laws of things we're supposed to do, there's no justification for doing that on Kantian grounds. There's no way you could know that. Or he talks specifically in this book about grace. You could have this experience that Schleiermacher is describing of what feels like a divine effect on you, but you can't actually know that God is causing that. That's outside of the sphere of perception.
I quickly put down, I'll confess, Religion Within the Boundaries of Bare Reason, because I just didn't find it was really speaking to the God issue very well. It seemed to be speaking more to the church and to morality. The Critique of Practical Reason had some really interesting comments, and I think perhaps shows an interesting way in which Kant tries to get to religion in a way that very sharply distinguishes itself from Schleiermacher. As you said, Mark, you can't get to God through any sense of reason. But according to his postulates, if there is a highest good to be attained, what he called the summum bonum, and because you know you can never actually attain the highest ethical good while you're still alive, because it's in the nature of people, perhaps this blends in well with Religion Within the Boundaries of Bare Reason, but because it's within the nature of people to always want to do the right thing for what they can get out of it, and it's never for itself. And if we're going to postulate that the highest good must be possible because you can't posit an ethical rule that can't be attained, then Kant seems to make this, what I thought, innovative, although I think it's a move that fails, but it's this really innovative move to say there must be a God and there must be an immortality, because how on earth could you possibly get to the highest good on this life? You can't live long enough to get to the highest good. It's something that you can only approach asymptotically, and therefore immortality must exist, says Kant in the middle of Critique of Practical Reason, because otherwise there is no way to approach the highest good.
Well, we do know that from his epistemology, what the function of the faculty of reason is, right? Which is, reason is something that tries to extend every concept to its limit, right? So not only is causality apply to things in the world that I can experience, it must apply to everything. It tries to reach out. And so it gives us some concepts. And one of these is the concept of the infinite at all.
Right.
It's exactly something we get. I was going to tie this into our mathematics discussion of last time. The idea that, so we set up this practice of counting things, say.
Right.
1, 2, 3. Then immediately reason jumps up and posits the infinite. And there's really nothing in our experience that can assure us that there are an infinite number of things to be counted.
And yet we feel it, don't we?
We get that concept in any case.
Right.
So that's where reason comes in. On the other hand, since reason is clearly going beyond its proper bounds, which is what reason always does,
sure.
Then the critique of pure reason is meant to say, okay, that doesn't give us positive knowledge. But as a practical matter, if you imagine doing the right thing, or what's the maxim that's going to always drive the right actions, then it's very natural to sort of imagine being perfectly ethical. And reason itself, in the same way that, you know, it jumps from 1, 2, 3 to infinite, jumps from these applicable ethical maxims to some model of perfection and to a lawgiver who sets this law.
That's right.
And to this, we even talked about in the ethics episode, the kingdom of ends,
mm-hmm.
This utopian sort of, if everybody were to obey the categorical imperative and act ethically all the time, then we would end up with this perfect harmony. And so that's, like you're saying, what we're asymptotically stretching toward. So these things are just, as a practical matter, we posit the perfect saint and the perfect law and the perfect world as things that we move toward.
Right.
And so we can't say for sure that they're there. But since, as a practical matter, I mean, we can't say for sure that the ethical law is there in some sense. We don't experience it.
Did Kant posit the highest good as an axiom? Is it something? Because I got the sense from the argument that, look, we have to accept that there is such a thing as a highest good. And it's a necessary corollary of the highest good that you must be able to attain it. And then from there, he kind of goes on to these subsequent corollaries to say that you can't know this in the way that you can conceptualize, say, synthetic or analytic concepts, but you can infer from the initial summum bonum, from the initial highest good, that you have to be able to attain it. And the only way that would be possible is to gain immortality and to live in this kind of higher plane. I just thought that was interesting because Schleiermacher doesn't have any use for that. This is the cash payout of the different approaches, that in some ways Kant gives you immortality and a god, which you tend to ascribe more toward a positive doctrinal religion. Schleiermacher takes this phenomenological approach. And how does he end the second speech? Spoiler alert. There is no personal God and there is no immortality.
Well, we can come back to that.
Okay.
Just to dwell on the Kant a little more, I've never been comfortable with these. I think I understand the ethical argument from practical reason, but I think that his support for religion is even one step further removed from that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there is a similarity between Kant's and Schleiermacher's take on the connection between moral action and positing religious things, in that for Schleiermacher, we have this religious feeling, and it doesn't tell you specifically, do not kill. It's certainly when we try to think, right, when we try to express what this inexpressible thing is, it's a very natural, it's going to affect how we act. And I think people can understand this, right? If you are having a loving and calm disposition that embraces the universe, you're not going to go around being a serial killer. That would make a very interesting novel about a serial killer that has this sort of Zen disposition, or the hitman. But at least for Schleiermacher, it's just obvious that no hostility is going to come out of this. So there's an indirect relationship between, it's not that religion dictates these moral things in
right.
the sense that it gives you laws you have to follow, but it puts you in a mood
there you go.
To accept these moral things.
Well, that's right. And the sense that I get is that once you've had this magic experience, I guess magic isn't the right word, but it's certainly a rare experience. I mean, he himself describes it as something that's only fleeting for those people who've ever experienced it. But once you've had it, I get the sense that that becomes one of these life-changing events that you hear about that really just radically, it's a kind of almost Buddhist-like enlightenment that you attain that then helps you better comport yourself toward ethical rules. It's not apart from ethics in the sense that it's opposed to ethics or that it's completely divorced from ethics. It's just that it informs your ethics. Those are the three realms that Schleiermacher devises in the second speech, which is that of knowing, that of acting, and this religious sense of feeling. One informs the other, even though they're separate, but they're not so divorced that they have absolutely nothing to do with one another. And so, as you said, you know, if you have this religious experience, this religious sense of feeling, then it's presumably just going to be easier for you to act ethically. Whereas with Kant, I think a lot of us could say, well, you could certainly understand through Kant to know what the right thing to do is. It just doesn't mean you're going to get there.
Let me finish the analogy. For Kant, accepting the ethical law is almost conversely causal, that accepting the ethical law puts you in the mindset. It doesn't logically entail that you have to believe in God, but it does put you in the mindset that to act ethically on a consistent basis, right, to be virtuous means to adopt certain ideals. And adopting the language of religion in talking about these as a lawgiver, and he even talks about a little in this, the evil principle in this book too of religion within the limits of reason alone, talks about, you know, of course, when we're trying to obey the categorical imperative, which is the dictates of reason, that we have all these things, these other desires that are constantly trying to pull us away from that, right? So it's like we have this constant temptation. And he says it doesn't even really matter if you conceive of that as internal or external. In other words, the image of a devil tempting you with these things, fine, that's perfectly apt to what's going on, as long as you don't take it too seriously. Just like we can say that the advanced objects of particle physics are really just, maybe we're not referring to an actual object when I talk about a quark in the same way that I'm referring to a glass when I talk about this glass in front of me. What I'm referring to in a shorthand is for all these phenomena, or I'm trying to sum up a whole experience. It's just simpler for me to just talk about quarks as if they were objects.
It's a shorthand, sure.
Exactly. And so that's the same thing. You might as well just talk about the devil when you're talking about this whole phenomenon of you being tempted by the various desires that are pulling at you, and talk about God when you're talking about a lawgiver, as long as you're just clear that that's where these concepts came from and you can sort of retrace them back to their origin, then you won't be exceeding the way human knowledge works.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Wes, come on, man.
Give us your Kant verdict.
No, I mean, I think that's right. I think you guys have done a good job of explaining it. I'm not particularly strong on Kant and religion.
We'd argued a little that you stress the skeptical parts of Kant, just that, as sort of came out of our epistemology episode, that this whole setup of the faculties really just gets science out of the business of talking about metaphysics, such that faith has room. So you could believe or not believe, but Kant, I remember you saying, oh no, Kant doesn't have any sort of backdoor argument that you really should believe. But this is what I have always understood it to be, that it's not a direct argument. It's what I call an indirect argument. It's almost like it's beneficial for you to believe, so you should believe it. But it's not, it's a more subtle than that.
Well, it's not a proof in the sense that he's talking about the need of a God to ground a moral order.
Mm-hmm.
And then the requirement of a moral order to make sure that practical action is something that's rational. Really, it's ultimately grounding the rationality of one's practical behavior. A lot of his epistemological stuff, he's starting with the idea that the sciences and geometry are sure things. And that's a solid foundation for making a lot of critiques. But the idea that once you get to the level of practical reason, I don't think you're on a knowledge footing anymore. So for Kant to say that, well, for moral agency to be rational, we require a God, is not to say, well, we've proved God, because ultimately a proof would have something to do with knowledge and with the empirical sciences. Once you've sort of accepted this moral enterprise, and then you can get yourself to the belief in God. But that's not a matter of knowledge of anything.
And nothing forces
it's
you to
accept
the enterprise.
It's completely a matter of faith. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So can we tie this back to Schleiermacher then and see, well, Schleiermacher's response to that is, what a horribly dry and unsatisfying and hypercritical view of religious feeling. Where's the beef? Where's the emotion? Why on earth would I believe this? Why not just save a step and say that there is no God?
In other words, he's saying that Kant's this very indirect proof is, insofar as it's a proof at all, pretty weak, which I think is pretty uncontroversial.
There are modern figures arguing for the moral argument for the existence of God. In fact, I think that's one of their primary tactics.
Who do you have in mind?
Like this guy, Daniel or something, Lane Craig. He's not very good.
No. Well, that was that video you posted.
Well, he was in that debate, and then I've looked at other debates in some of his writings. He's written a lot about the cosmological argument as well. The cosmological argument actually has its defenders, including Kunz, this guy that is a professor at UT, and he was there when Mark and I were there. He's a big defender of the cosmological argument using mereology. So there are modern defenders of these arguments. The ontological, the cosmological, the moral arguments for the existence of God actually have their defenders.
Well, they have their defenders. If I can just jump in, I mean, I think for most people who are trying to decide whether or not religion is anything in which one can believe or feel or guide one's actions, it's pretty thin gruel. It's really not going to get either. I agree, there are people who are in the business of making arguments who've decided to hang their hat on that particular mode of approach, but they don't seem to be winning the war in terms of trying to get people to accept it or to be particularly persuasive. It certainly doesn't seem to be guiding mass understanding of religion.
Well, again, it's also a matter of what kind of God you can get out of it. Right,
exactly.
And what's interesting is when you look at these debates, for instance, about the cosmological argument, for those arguing against it, the necessary being becomes the universe itself, right? Because it just appears out of nowhere, Big Bang, right? And then you say, well, is it really that much better if you get a God out of this, the necessary being who caused the existence of the universe? And now he's this sort of tabula rasa, you can put whatever properties you want on him, this impersonal sort of God. The point is that these abstract, rational arguments about the existence of this unmoved mover fail to get at this experience of piety and the feeling slash intuition that Schleiermacher wants to focus on. What he's interested in is religious experience, and that hard to describe feeling of, let's say, oneness with the universe, going back to the subject-object fusion, or you could call it the sense of one's own abject dependence on everything else that exists in the world, something like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a shortcoming with Kant. What most people will find convincing, and I think this is one of the rhetorical tricks he uses in what we've read for tonight, he asks the audience to, says ultimately, you'll need to have the experience. I think this is near the beginning of the first. So, but anyway, ultimately, you need to find your way to that experience. That's what's going to be convincing, not these sorts of abstract arguments.
Right.
Of course, just through the cosmological argument, we know that if there's something lesser, it has to come from something greater. So the fact that there are lots of mustaches in the world, therefore God must have a better, bigger mustache than any of the real mustaches. So therefore, we know that God has a giant, cool mustache.
Right. All contingent mustaches must be grounded in a necessary mustache.
Schleiermacher is just right on point as far as the culture despisers that he is addressing. At least I'm reading into it all the things that I don't like about religion. So we got some blowback from at least one person for our Kierkegaard episode, which ultimately came down to, why is it on internet kind of things? And I guess this guy thought on our episode that people just assume that religion is bullshit and that atheism is the default position and doesn't need any argument. Now, of course, we will argue about such things, and we're going to have a specific episode on the new atheists coming up. But sort of as the prima facie argument that these culture despisers would have against religion, first of all, it's just weird, right? The basic religious doctrines are just weird.
Yeah.
I've been not wanting to say this, but I pictured this beforehand. If I had to give one sentence for sort of what the atheist view is, and this is obviously not an argument, but you know, why would I even want to be reading about religion? First of all, it's stupid. And second of all, it causes a lot of trouble, right? People that believe in this crap go and blow up buildings and stuff. So that's the two prongs of the argument that I think he has to address here. And first he's saying, you know, all the stuff you thought was stupid, all these stories about people being born from gods that is the same as in Greek mythology. Fine, let's throw all that away. Anything that you could object to on the grounds of it just being irrational and anti-scientific, let's just grant you all that. And then he confronts the second part, which is to describe, you know, if you really understood what religion is about, which is this pious feeling, this experience, you would see that's not going to cause people to go blow up buildings or really do anything else that's hostile at all. In fact, there's a great danger of people that are pious in this way just doing nothing, of just meditating themselves, right, and never coming out of their cave again. That's the danger for them, not blowing up stuff. And he sketches out in some of these subsequent speeches how the true church of these enlightened people dealing with each other on an egalitarian basis and trying to learn from each other inevitably comes into contact with society and people with all this hostility and power structures that are already in place, and all these people that don't have the spirit of religion at all, getting appointed to clerical positions. All this stuff that you think is bad about what people do from religion, that's just all this external crap getting glommed onto it. But it itself is pure and inoffensive.
I think he describes it as a kind of a base alloy, right? That's what religion has become through these accretions of dogmatics. And within it is the actual pure metal, but it's just become mixed with baser elements over the centuries.
Yeah, and I find that argument pretty convincing.
Yeah.
The subject came up with a friend, but I was looking up the death toll for World War II, the total death toll, civilians and military casualties from countries, and it's something like 50 to 70 million, depending on how you calculate. I was thinking about that in light of another, I've been looking at some of these debates with Christopher Hitchens, and one of his talks is about all the trouble that religion can cause, all the right. silly wars, and really, of course, you don't need religion to have a really, really horrific death toll. All you need is some sort of idea or ideology, yeah. some sort of political yeah. ideology. And then, of course, there's an interesting question of where religion stops and where, say, something like National Socialism begins. There may be some religious sentiment involved in...
Right, deifying Hitler. Or
yeah, the Führer and the Fatherland. So in the same way that you can blame religion for human ills, you could take any institution, you know, in the same way people in this country talk about how horrible the government is, let's get rid of the government. Well, yes, because human beings are involved in it, and human beings do stupid things. And no, it doesn't mean that we get rid of the government, because governments historically are responsible for dumb things. So the same thing goes for religion. I think it's a weak argument.
Hey, man, governments have conducted most of the wars in yeah, history.
Exactly.
So fuck governments.
Exactly.
Schleiermacher's response to this really sets a pattern for what seems like a very reasonable response, a live option to me. Does this get you wanting to be more spiritual in some way?
I'm not so much taken with Schleiermacher's answer as I am with his mission. Then as now, there are educated people who are torn between dogmatic forms of belief, which doesn't always have to be about religion, but people are torn between positive assertions and how to cope with that, and endless skepticism and scrutiny and how to cope with that. And religion is one of the ways that manifests itself as a pathology. And there are a great many people, I'll admit I'm one of them, who would like to be able to get to religion. I feel as though it's a kind of a hunger that hasn't been satisfied my entire life. But all of the options on offer have been wanting for one reason or another. And you guys have touched upon a lot of it right now. I respect about Schleiermacher that he is really trying to say, look, those aren't the only options on offer. You aren't forced between believing in nonsense or so abstracting out a sense of religion that it becomes something that's not even religion at all. There is this third way, which is this phenomenological emotional approach, which I find satisfying in a sense because the need or the desire, perhaps is a better way to say it, to try to get to religion is itself, at least for me, it's an emotional need. But I think there are other answers to that besides Schleiermacher, right? I mean, Freud has one. Any number of thinkers that you guys have covered have had other answers to the question of why are people trying to search out for these kinds of answers. I like the sincerity of Schleiermacher's approach. I like the fact that he is addressing himself to a bunch of urbane cynics who feel as though they are above it, but are interested enough to hear him out. Schleiermacher really did have a very serious impact with this book on some of the people in his circle. And I think that perhaps the way to say it is that people will come to religion for reasons that they can't quite put their finger on. And I like the fact that Schleiermacher is trying to say, look, if it's an emotional need that's carrying you there, you should recognize that within yourself. But there is this kind of intuitive feeling that will give you access to this mysterious sense of religion and holiness that's out there. And he gives you this tool which you can criticize and say, how do you know you're not kidding yourself? It sounds like a lot of the kind of goofy innate knowledge that Locke used to criticize. But I appreciate the approach. I like the fact that he's come up with a non-silly way to try to answer that need. Has he persuaded me? Probably depends on the day you ask.
Well, I think it's, in a way, it's a matter of whether or not one has those sorts of religious experiences, right? It's not really a matter right. of persuasion. It's just a matter of making you aware of the possibility of such experiences, and then you have to sort of, I guess, grace would be the, you know, you're hoping for some grace to have those types of experiences. I mean, for me, I've sought after religious experience through philosophy and literature and art, which is, I think, one of the things he's actually arguing against here to his hedonist artist friends. No, art and poetry are not going to serve as replacements. There's something...
They're subordinate to religion,
there's something
says.
Different, yeah.
Right.
And I've always, and this is one of the reasons why I find myself upset with the new atheists, beyond the shallowness of the debate, I think there's a lack of appreciation on the part of a lot of people for, let's say, the fundamental mysteriousness of the world. I have the seed of that feeling that's always there. Now, can I say that it leads me to a lot of religious experiences, even in the broadest sense? I mean, no, I'm really not on a daily basis connected Will that change? I don't know. That is not something I'm actively seeking. And I certainly can't imagine myself ever going to church regularly. So positive religion is really, really be a stretch. But even this sort of more, I don't want to call it abstracted because he's fighting against that as well. But even this sort of, let's say, personal religion approach, despite my appreciation for it, I can't say it's a part of my life.
First of all, I don't know that he's talking about religious experiences as Satori peak experience that you have to meditate for a long time and maybe you'll obtain it. The kind of thing that William James is writing about in the varieties of religious experience. I don't think that's his focus. I think that piety is really what he's after, which is just an attitude. It's almost something that any of us are able to get at. And if we have the proper spirit, we can get at it again. And again, I'm reminded of Nietzsche and then correspondingly of this book that maybe we'll eventually read, some of Robert Solomon's Spirituality for the Skeptic, which really focuses on those parts of Nietzsche and Hegel that are about spirit, about feeling this connectedness to other people, about just having an energized, meaningful life, right? All the things that existentialism is trying to address. So you could argue that, okay, Schleiermacher, you're recognizing a legitimate thing. He points out, for instance, that people who are obsessed with scholarship or science, they get focused on one thing, right? This object of their knowledge, of their interest. And it doesn't really connect back to their own lives, right? It makes them almost a shell of a person because they're so put into this external thing. And if you're a good scholar, even according to Schleiermacher, you need to have that enriched by the sort of the way it balances with the rest of your life, with this overall spirituality. And again, he puts that very literally in terms of realizing that any particular finite object of experience is part of a whole, and realizing that you are part of a whole. And so he talks about human nature, for instance, the fact that all of us can sympathize with each other. And this is what art does. It enables us to understand other people by putting ourselves in their shoes, by trying to convey our emotions to other people. And just the fact that we are able to do that, it's not just a matter of, you know, that we're these individual souls that can relate to each other. He thinks this very literally, like this is what the mystical experience is mm-hmm. realizing this connectedness right. that we all have.
So he's responsible for the spiritual but not religious category on online dating sites, which everyone seems to belong to.
Yes, and I was just in very direct contact with this at a funeral, and it's a Unitarian service. So Unitarianism, if folks that are not that familiar with, it kind of like a liberal kind of Christianity, but really it's non-denominational. It's like, we're open to all faiths, sort of whatever you want to believe is fine. Probably most of the ministers are atheists. So what words of comfort do these atheists have to offer? And it's really all about realizing our closeness with other people and the continuity between people. And I don't know if it gives you as much to grasp on as, you know, yeah. your loved ones are there in heaven and you're going to get to join them.
Yeah, it's kind of bland. I went to a Unitarian service when I was in Savannah, which is my hometown, to the Jingle Bells Church. It's a Unitarian church, and the guy who composed Jingle Bells went there, apparently. So they call it the Jingle Bells Church. So, and it's a very bland, there's very little decoration in the room. And, you know, I think we read from Emerson, the book of Emerson. There's no Bibles.
There's still, it's got the singing, it's got the candle lighting, it's got the...
It's got some ritual.
It's for people that were raised going to church and like going to church and like the community and like the actual act of what happens in a service and listening to somebody say something that's supposed to make you think, which is all too rare in our society as it is. I wouldn't want to be doing that every week myself. That's just a personal aesthetic thing.
Schleiermacher didn't feel that there was any need to go to church.
Right. In fact, he said it could be a bad thing.
Right. And this is one of the areas in which he apparently got into a real academic dispute with Hegel. He was actually instrumental in having Hegel appointed to a position at the University of Berlin. There was an academic rival he wanted ousted, and Hegel looked like a good alternative. But one of the sources of contention between Hegel and Schleiermacher was the role of the church. And Hegel really felt that the church was necessary in order to be able to mediate religion through society.
I also had an experience of, I went to a spiritual retreat in Maine, which also involved learning how to build wooden boats. And we did Bible study, which really consisted of listening to the guy who ran the place, who was a minister, debunk certain biblical stories, like try and explain away in naturalistic terms Moses's, you know, Red Sea trick, which was very interesting to me. And this is, by the way, this tradition comes directly out of liberal theology, comes, of course, right out of Schleiermacher. It had a profound effect in the United States. There's a strong liberal Christian religious tradition in the United States, especially in the Northeast and the Midwest, where, ironically, when people do Bible study, they mean, let's debunk all the miracles in the Bible. And then there were some Quaker elements to that. I found the whole experience to be, let's say, quote-unquote, spiritual, minus the Bible study part. But the whole experience of being there with that community, I wanted to mention that at some point in the podcast, that there is actually this significant tradition in the United States that comes directly out of the type of theology Schleiermacher is doing here.
Yeah, I was raised a United Church of Christ, which they specifically had a, there are lots of ways to God, here's one.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, exactly.
I like that maxim, that the very fact that you feel that need, if you feel that need, says something, and that there may be answers to it. I want to read a quote from the second speech.
Please.
If only so that we can give the listener some knowledge from the text, and also
the flavor.
It has a flavor to it. It's very much of the romantic moment. It's kind of saturated in this emotional feeling. But it also, I think, describes the phenomenology I was describing before. This is in the middle of the second speech. Did I venture to compare it, seeing I cannot describe it? I would say it is as fleeting and transparent as the vapor which the dew breathes on blossom and fruit. It is bashful and tender as a maiden's kiss. It is holy and fruitful as a bridal embrace. Nor is it merely like. It is all this. It is the first contact of the universal life with an individual. It fills no time and fashions nothing palpable. It is the holy wedlock of the universe with the incarnated reason for a creative, productive embrace. Which is, let's face it, guys, that's erotic talk there. It is immediate, raised above all error and misunderstanding. You lie directly on the bosom of the infinite world. In that moment, you are its soul. Through one part of your nature, you feel, as your own, all its powers and its endless life. In that moment, it is your body you pervade, as your own, its muscles and members, and your thinking and forecasting set its inmost nerves in motion. In this way, every living, original moment in your life is first received. Among the rest, it is the source of every religious emotion. But it is not, as I said, even a moment. The incoming of existence to us by this immediate union at once stops as soon as it reaches consciousness. Either the intuition displays itself more vividly and clearly, like the figure of the vanishing mistress to the eyes of her lover, or feeling issues from your heart and overspreads your whole being as the blush of shame and love over the face of the maiden. At length, your consciousness is finally determined as one or another, as intuition or feeling. Then, even though you have not quite surrendered to this division and lost consciousness of your life as a unity, there remains nothing but the knowledge that they were originally one, that they issued simultaneously from the fundamental relation of your nature. Wherefore, it is in this sense true what an ancient sage has taught you, that all knowledge is recollection. It is recollection of what is outside of all time, and is therefore justly to be placed at the head of all temporal things. Now, that's interesting language to me.
That's pretty.
Let's break that down a little bit.
Sure.
There's the pseudo-phenomenological bit in there, which I think I'm glad you read that part. So it's the initial moment of experience before you cognize anything.
Right.
As soon as you cognize, you are carving out an object. The understanding is reaching out and ripping something. You're doing damage to. So you can't really just do phenomenological reflection on this process because it's so instantaneous. But at the same time, somehow we're aware of it, or we could get ourselves in the right mood to be aware of it, or it's some emotional operation upon yourself that you can get at this sense of the whole. And it's not necessarily a matter of meditating or something, though I suppose that could definitely be a means to get there.
Right. I mean, he mentions that it's very much akin to the kind of nature worship that he accused the deists of being after. There are moments I've had, maybe you guys can think of this. To me, it's always been certain moments of looking at natural beauty, at which it just hits you like a slap in the face, that you're not looking at any one item. It's the entire flood of that vision. And Schleiermacher is careful in the second speech not to say that this is not nature worship, that nature can be horrible and awful or just bland and depressing just as much as it can be beautiful and glorious. But I think those are moments at which at least I feel like I can relate to what he might be talking about.
Yeah, it sounds like the oceanic feeling that Freud talks about, right?
Yeah.
Or the experience of the sublime.
That Freud talks about not being able to
I know.
Identify himself.
Right, which may say a lot, though, right? I mean, Schleiermacher is going to appeal to certain mentalities and certain intellects, and he's not going to appeal to others. I think he did appeal to the literary forces of the Romantic movement. You had mentioned, Wes, earlier, Emerson. I don't find Emerson bland. And one of the real joys I got from reading Schleiermacher was not so much Schleiermacher himself, but the access that he gave to the German Romantic poets of the time, of Hölderlin, of Novalis. Perhaps I'll try and post to it when the show goes up. What these poets in the Romantic era are doing, they try to capture what can't be captured in words, but they try to give you some way of approaching it. For me, it has, if nothing else, an aesthetic appeal. And it's rare for me that religion ever has an aesthetic appeal. As you pointed out, one needn't be Freud to say, that's all well and good, it's interesting, but it doesn't speak to me. And it probably wouldn't have spoken to me 20 years ago, frankly.
Certainly, whatever sort of special experiences you have, you can project those and, oh, this is what he's talking about. I have plenty of those from musical experiences, you know, going to church as a kid, mm-hmm. you know, and the candlelight thing and the organ and the choir and you're singing, like, yes, I get the warm flush out of that. Mm-hmm. I enjoyed church for that reason and I have sought out music since then to sort of reproduce some version of that feeling. I was also a great romantic, even to the age of 8 or 9 or something, of contemplating various females in my class and letting the warm waves wash over me. And of course, never actually talking to them.
Well, that would be a quick way to ruin the religious part of that experience.
Well, although what I found was so interesting about the section that I had quoted is that it's very erotic talk. When he's saying that it's not merely like a bridal embrace, but it is one, I figure that's about as close to that kind of language as one can get in 1799, to describing religion almost as an erotic feeling.
Actually, I read he wrote a defense of Schlegel's pornographic novel, right?
Yes, it was deemed pornographic at the time.
Speaking of erotic...
People think that Schlegel is just a made-up name because it rhymes with Hegel, but no. It's a real dude. It's
like we need one more romantic German philosopher. What's it going to be?
I think what's interesting about Schleiermacher is that he was trained somewhat in philosophy, but he was mostly a theologian, and he was hanging out with literary types. He was speaking to that sensibility, and I think that's why perhaps the three of us found this frustrating trying to read through it. I mean, even Kant, who could have used an editor, he's still trying to approach a lot of his arguments systematically. You don't see that here, which has its pleasures and has its problems, but let's just maybe just get into some of the critiques. Okay, so Schleiermacher says that there's this emotional experience, and if you haven't felt it yet, well, that's really just because you haven't felt it yet. That doesn't mean that what I'm saying is wrong. How do you know you're not just kidding yourself? How do you know that that's really an approach with infinity that you're having? How do you know that that's just not something internal within you? And you're feeling that that's access to God. There was a later writer, which I don't really want to get into, named Feuerbach, who really took what Schleiermacher was talking about head on and just said, look, that's just religion based upon anthropological projections. You're experiencing your world and you're assigning it a kind of divinity that isn't really there. It's just a purely natural phenomenon. And Hegel, I think, had very much that same approach too.
But wouldn't Schleiermacher be able to say, the point is it's a human function. You think you're having an experience of the infinite. How do you know it's the infinite? I don't think personally that we have an experience of the infinite at all, that whatever that is, it's something else. But fine, call it something else. Mm-hmm. Still, if that is a part of what it is to be a whole spiritual person, and you need that there, according to Schleiermacher, to support, you know, all your rational inquiries, if you're not going to just be some automaton that's just blindly investigating this and that, but it never sort of connects up and it never means anything, or the thing that Kant is accused of morally, of having this sort of soulless, slavish devotion to duty, you know, to actually make the duty your own and do all that stuff. Like, in some ways, who cares? Could you have a religion and just acknowledge that it is a human thing?
Feuerbach would be, Ludwig Feuerbach was a German who followed that very thesis and did so very cogently. I think you would agree with a lot of what he had said, which is, effectively religion as a purely human creation.
And I guess, can you do that and still talk about God, for instance, and just say, look, what I mean by God is not this objectively existing thing that was there at the beginning of time and that created whatever. I'm referring to God, again, in the same way that the high-powered physicists right. refer to quarks, as a shorthand for this thing. And phenomenologically, it serves the same purpose. It doesn't matter mm-hmm. if there is such an independent creature out there or not, because we can still fulfill all of the spiritual, personal, and social purposes that that serves through these experiences and the sharing of the experiences with other and all this kind
right.
of stuff.
I just wonder, it seems as though that direction in religion has passed by, although perhaps I'm wrong. I mean, do we live in a post Schleiermacher age, or do we live in an age that essentially rejected Schleiermacher and decided to go back to dogmatics? I just feel that having grown up in America in the late 20th century, there wasn't a whole lot of liberalism in the religion that I heard being espoused by my neighbors and whatnot. I didn't grow up in a religious household, but certainly I was surrounded by people of various Christian faiths that their religion looked a lot more like Jim and Tammy Faye than it did like Schleiermacher.
Yeah, but there are liberal churches everywhere in this tradition, you know, right. Unitarian and otherwise.
I probably just didn't hear from them because they didn't feel the need to kind of spew their dogmatics at me.
Right, they're not out of your clue.
They were there the whole time. They were just minding their own business like I was.
Let me share the good word with you. Come to our church or really any church or don't.
Right, right.
Yeah, after reading Dennett about the spread of religions and analyzing it in terms of memes and, you know, the most successful religions are the ones that the ideas will spread themselves and be immune to challenge. You know, they're constructed. Yeah. So in some ways, looking at it from this Darwinist perspective, the most open-minded kind of religions that are not trying to push themselves on others, those are the ones that will die off by nature. I don't think this contradicts Schleiermacher. According to Schleiermacher, there can never be an age of Schleiermacher. Mm-hmm. He's at least optimistic, maybe, that things will move forward to have an overall more spiritual climate so that people can have the space to think and reflect and become truly religious. But he certainly thinks that in all existing religions, even though, again, he wants to say that the foundations of all these things and the fundamental documents that drive them, that there's definitely something real, the true churches in them. But then inevitably, it's going to be only a very small group of people are going to really get it. But you need, he still says, and this is like in the fourth speech, that you might think from this that I would say throw away the church, because the true church is going to be of necessity this very small, non-hierarchical, sharing community. But really, there needs to be some way to get the neophytes into it too.
Right.
And in fact, that's in his notes when he's saying, oh, I'm really not a Spinozist and things. When it's his notes from later, he's really saying that, for instance, the idea of a personal God, yes, that's dangerous because then you can start thinking of him as a jealous God. You can start really distinguishing God as being one object when really God is the whole. I mean, it's very hard to have a personal God notion in your mind without it slipping into idolatry, according to him. But still, you can use these things as teaching tools to inspire them into getting in touch with themselves. And once you're there, once you've had those experiences and you're an overall spiritual person, then you see it everywhere and you can read the Bible and you can read other things like that with new eyes and say, oh, okay, yes, I see how that's an expression, how that's an artistic expression. And again, he really connects artistic and religious expression, yes, which is very much my attitude toward art. Like, I really feel like you can't just listen to one album or look at one painting by somebody. You have to really get a really good feel to where you're coming from. And then you can put all the works over time in perspective and see the germ of genius or of personal expression that is there, even in the shittiest of them. And so you could do the same thing with the Bible, that once you really get Christianity, you can go through and say, okay, here's the really meaningful parts and this is what I should preach on. But you'll see the shreds of it, even though it's kind of the dead letter. Mm-hmm. It's the after effect of some spirituality that then is, you know, third or fourth hand and noted down, but you'll see the inspiration that's in there.
And he said somewhere at the end of the second speech, I think, that the problem is that too many people use the Bible to inform their metaphysics. What they need to do is have their metaphysics inform how they read the Bible. Of course, the practical upshot of that, I think, is to just do away with 80% of the text, ultimately.
Well, that's the hermeneutics.
Exactly. I think it's an interesting approach. I find it more satisfying than trying to accept dogmatics, which ultimately feel based upon authority. In that sense, I think there's value to Schleiermacher for those people who are seeking it. Why you should seek it at all is probably another question.
I think he makes a pretty persuasive argument for this general spirituality. Again, I don't think it makes the whole jump to, there's a guy that I worked with in undergrad, Michael Brooks, who's sort of a leader of the Jewish community in the University of Michigan area. And he really emphasized that you should just go with whatever tradition has been handed down to you. He was a very liberal, spiritual, independent thinker. But the point is that the stuff has to be articulated in some way, and you're going to find it more rewarding. In fact, he described, before he became full-on religious, a dream he'd had of going through an attic and finding all these wonderful things that his ancestors had left for him. And that's how he sees his exploration of Judaism historically and the texts involved, is really applying himself to this religion. And it takes practice, you know, the same way, you know, it takes scholarship, it takes understanding of these things to learn how to read, to apply the hermeneutics to the text, to get what you're supposed to get out of them, to really put yourself in that point of view. So you're not going to, just by being generally spiritual in a Emerson sort of way, mm-hmm. you're not going to be able to get the most out of what he thinks religion has to offer. You know, in other words, there is a reason for carrying it all the way to religion as opposed to generic spirituality.
Interesting.
The interesting contrast, though, is that, and I heard this in other places too, maybe the our modern emphasis on dogmatics and what do you believe is kind of misguided, that maybe we should be emphasizing, as the Jews do, on ritual. Lots of religions do this.
Catholicism is usually referred to in the same way, right?
Yes.
That the value of it is
right.
The ritual.
And I think there's an important thing, like Schleiermacher is very critical of ritual, that he thinks, you know, all this, what a waste of time, and you could be doing all these actions and it's just empty. There's nothing.
They're just human accretions, right?
Yes, yes. But at the same time, there's a point from Marx that we brought up, which is the mind will follow what the body does. For instance, if you find yourself like, I no longer love my wife, you might say, or your husband. Well, maybe the way to get past that is just act like you love them. Just go through all the motions. Just do all the stuff and you'll find the feeling comes. It was there before, it'll come back. You're just having a bad day. So Marx said that that was just change the material circumstances of people and they will adjust their beliefs to sort of rationalize whatever situation they're in. I don't know how much I really trust that. If I really didn't love my wife, I might give that a try, but I wouldn't hold out faith. I'm just not doing it right. Maybe if you're just in a miserable situation, it's just because it's miserable and pretending is just going to be pretending and it's going to be hollow, just like Schleiermacher is saying. So I'm not sure I put that much faith. It seems more a rule of thumb than a diehard rule for life for me. So you could see it coming from both ways, right? Schleiermacher doesn't like ritual for that reason. But from what it was presented to me, you know, through Judaism and Catholicism and I guess other things is, well, do the ritual. That's part of getting yourself in the appropriate frame of mind to have the spiritual experience.
Right. I think that's a good way to look at it. Just some other comments on Schleiermacher that I called up as I was researching this was Hegel had, I thought, a good witty riposte to Schleiermacher, which went as follows. If religion grounds itself in a person only on the basis of feeling, then a dog would be the best Christian, for it carries this feeling more intensely within itself and lives principally satisfied by a bone. Which,
yeah, I read that as well.
Yeah, I thought that was amusing.
But that's a profound misunderstanding of what an emotion is, right?
I think so.
Oh, there's my reason on one side and there's my emotion on the other. Whereas I will again attribute this to Robert Solomon in his book, The Passions, that every emotion, if it's not just a feeling like nausea, involves some cognitive component. So in this sense, dogs don't have, unless you want to say, yes, even though dogs don't have language, they could have beliefs. The dog believes that I am his master, and so it feels love for me because he has this feeling of pleasure, but then it's accompanied by this belief that I am the cause of the pleasure and that I am his friend. This is exactly Spinoza, actually. Spinoza is a primary influence on Schleiermacher, so he's going to respond to that and say, that's just bullshit. Dogs don't have that kind of feeling that religious people have. That's not the same kind of feeling, and if you had that inner experience of that, there's no way you would make that confusion.
So you think that, if I get you right, there are certain emotions that are only within reach of higher order primates. I think one can see when your dog is upset about something or a cat is frustrated about something. And certainly anyone who's ever watched octopuses on the Nature Channel will see that they can very visibly display what emotion they're feeling at a given moment based upon how they change their skin color. But there's a difference between just very primal emotion like rage, fear, anger, protectiveness, territorialism, and angst.
Yes. Well, and piety. I mean, that's the...
Or piety or awe. Yeah.
Right. Piety assumes the existence... It's hard to say exactly what the belief is that it entails, but it has a cognitive component. And like you were saying, Wes, sometimes he describes that as a feeling of absolute dependence on the universe or of surrender, of submission to God, but really to the all. I mean, you don't even... We're just putting the name God on that. And that's just something that unless you can have that concept, insofar as it even is a concept, in some ways it's just a negative concept, right? Not finite, but it has an emotional punch and we're able to have, I don't know if you want to say an emotional relationship with that exactly, but an emotional relationship in light of that.
If I could, I want to jump into something I touched upon at the beginning, and Mark, you had some reservations about it, so maybe we'll just engage it now. What I thought was interesting about the conclusion to the second speech was the fact that he said, let's address what you, the cultured despisers, tend to think typifies what religion is about, which is God and immortality. Well, I'm here to tell you, you don't have to worry about it, because there is no God, in the sense that there's no personalized God, And there is no immortality. Immortality only exists as your conceptualization of the infinite right now. My conception of religion isn't going to be this sense that you're going to go to a heaven when you die or any kind of conceptualizable sensate afterlife. You will simply just annihilate when you're gone. And that shouldn't be a problem. And he goes on to, you know, he takes some time to explain why he thinks that shouldn't be a problem. And he refers back to the old Lucretian argument against fear of death, which is none of us can remember a time before we were born. And none of us feel any particular anxiety about the fact that we have no conception of what existence was like before our births. That doesn't cause any fear. That doesn't cause any anxiety. But it also proves that you can't literally be immortal because you didn't exist prior to your birth. But in any event, why would you worry about your death? Because it will be exactly the same as prior to your existence. There will simply be nothingness. There won't be anything to worry about. He spends some time about that.
Actually, I think reading some of what he has to say about immortality would help us be specific about this. He says, God and immortality, as they are found in such doctrines, are ideas. As ideas, they can have no greater value in religion than ideas generally. And he's already said, ideas are not what religion is about. And elsewhere he says, this now brings me to my second point, to immortality. I cannot conceal that in the usual manner of treating this subject, there's still more that seems to be inconsistent with the nature of piety. I believe I've just shown you in the way that each one bears in himself an unchangeable and eternal nature. If our feeling nowhere attaches itself to the individual, but if it's content in our relationship to God, wherein all that is individual and fleeting disappears, there can be nothing fleeting in it, but all must be eternal. Which this sounds very much like Spinoza, right? Spinoza said, like, ooh, we all participate in mankind. And in that sense, insofar as we are free of the particularizing emotions or something, then we are, actually, I'm pointing out the contrast with Spinoza here. For Spinoza, insofar as we are reasonable, we're participating in the general form of humanity or something like that. And insofar as we are, then we will live on after death. But the point of connection to Schleiermacher here is what's important about us is our unity with the whole. Mm-hmm. And in fact, this whole, oh, I want to continue as my own self after my death, my individuality. Like, that right. is the definition of irreligion, according to him.
Right.
Religion is turning away from the finite, from the particular, toward the whole, and focusing on the whole and rejoicing in our oneness with the whole. So even if when we die, we just become one with the whole, and in that sense, we're immortal. And in fact, I can realize my immortality right now because I realize right. my oneness with the whole and unchanging. And that's all you need.
Well, it sounds like we agree with one another then.
Well, it's not like he's positively saying there is no immortality in the particular sense that you think, because that, again, would be a factual claim. He's not making a factual claim either way, right? If you can't make the positive one, you can't make the negative one either.
We'll just do a little battle of the quotes here, which is in the same paragraph, so it's not too far of a jump. And it says here, but the immortality that most men imagine and their longing for it seem to me irreligious,
yes.
nay, quite opposed to the spirit of piety. Dislike to the very aim of religion is the ground of their wish to be immortal. And let's do that again.
Right. Personal immortality.
Personal immortality. Dislike to the very aim of religion is the ground of their wish to be immortal. Recall how religion earnestly strives to expand the sharply cut outlines of personality. Gradually they are to be lost in the infinite, that we, becoming conscious of the universe, may as much as possible be one with it. But men struggle against this aim. They are anxious about their personality and do not wish to overstep the accustomed limit or to be anything else but a manifestation of it, that is, manifestation of their own personality. Mm-hmm. The one opportunity that death gives them of transcending it, they are very far from wishing to embrace. On the contrary, they are concerned as to how they are to carry it with them beyond this life, and their utmost endeavor is for longer sight and better limbs. But God speaks to them as it stands written. Whoever loses his life for my sake, the same shall keep it, and whoever keeps it, the same shall lose it. The life that they would keep is the one that cannot be kept. If their concern is with the eternity of their single person, why are they not as anxious about what it has been as about what it is to be? What does forwards avail when they cannot go backwards? They desire an immortality that is no immortality. They're not even capable of comprehending it, for who can endure the effort to conceive an endless temporal existence? That vision of immortality is the one that I pretty much hear blared at me from every religious quarter, and not just right. in Christian quarters. I mean, that is today, I think, the prevailing solace that religion is meant to provide, is that there's a world beyond this one.
Right, but that doesn't rule out... It sounds like he's preserving a place for a certain type of immortality, right? It's just not personal immortality, so...
Right.
Whatever union with the whole, in the end, means the truer type of immortality doesn't mean that you as a personality persist.
It's just like this personification of God as being something within time that's an individual being. He's going to say, no, that falsifies it. If you think of immortality as like, I'm a ghost and I'm off in some other temporal realm, even if the time runs differently, just like in the last season of Lost, then, you know, that's still not really getting it. Like, the whole point is, when you die, we would be leaving the bounds of the temporal and the spatial. And so whatever form we exist in after that, we can't possibly understand it now. That's when the blinders come off and we see the reality. So you can still give a, I think, fairly traditional Christian view in the way I think what I just gave there is a traditional Christian view, but it's just resisting that urge to personify and saying, well, if you're thinking about it as, you know, I'm going to live in a land of daffodils, then that's just
the Elysian fields.
Yes, then
right,
you're just, that's just a way you dumb it down to introduce it to kids. But right, all adults who are serious about religion understand that God is not the guy with the big white beard and immortality is not the Elysian fields.
Well, I'll give you that nowadays, perhaps in the 21st century, but I've got to figure that there's a reason why Schleiermacher took as much effort as he did to make clear what he meant and didn't mean by immortality, which is that clearly that was as prevailing a view then as it is now amongst, you know, folk, let's say folk religion, was that you are going to join grandma in heaven, right? That's the sense that he's combating, and I can only assume he's combating it because that was the conceptualization of religion that the culture despisers were mocking then.
Again, if heaven, though, is just a stand-in word for something that we can't understand, but it involves this oneness, then you will be with grandma in heaven because the same thing happened to grandma as happening to you. There will be a reunion of some sort. It's just you can't imagine it.
You will be grandma in heaven.
Again, I just don't even know if he wants to be as specific as that.
I'll grant you
that. He's just not making positive assertions about these things that can't be comprehended.
So you think even that language that I quoted, you don't even think that's necessarily combating a particular view that was prevailing at the time necessarily?
I think it's the same multiple views have been around for these hundreds or thousands of years. That
right,
it's always hard for people to understand. There's just always these pulls of, do you make God more human and understandable and immortality something that we can get a hold of because that inspires belief and is really the kind of thing that makes us want to jump into? Or do you say, no, by definition, God is infinite and incomprehensible. So
right,
even the old church fathers would say exactly this. We're finite. We cannot understand an infinite being. So anything that we say right now is a gross approximation.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to recognize that it's a gross approximation if you're going to be truly religious. Schleiermacher is just following up on this, and I don't think he thinks he's saying anything original. He's saying something that he thinks all these people realized all along. Speech can only be approximate, but we can get closer to that infinite through our insight in some way.
Right.
And we can help others along that road. It's not just, oh, it's all just incomprehensible to us, so why the fuck should we worry about it?
No, it's a good way to put it. So let me come in then with another critique of this, since I think there was a reader of the blog who had anticipated we were going to try and mix it up with some amount of Kierkegaard talk in here. So let's have Kierkegaard enter into this with a big scary mask and say, wait a minute, we need immortality because somebody's got to judge your ass after you're dead. That seemed to be a serious point that Kierkegaard was making through a lot of his works was, unlike Kant, who said, well, one way in which you can kind of posit or pin your hopes on immortality is there's got to be some way to approach the highest good. Kierkegaard's approach was there has to be immortality of a sort because people have to be judged for their actions, which means immortality can be just as much a terrifying concept as it can be a hopeful affect.
My understanding of Kierkegaard is so limited, I don't even want to venture to think of what
too.
He okay. has to say about immortality in various writings and things like that, or judgment. I mean, from what I got is the important thing for Kierkegaard, just like for Schleiermacher, just like for any other cutting-edge Protestant, is your personal relationship with the divine, and that this has very complicated relationships with the ethical, for instance. So we had that whole transcendence of the ethical for Kierkegaard, and for Schleiermacher, it's, you can almost say the same thing, right? We've talked about how it's independent from the ethical, but yet it sort of puts you in the mood of the ethical. In another place, Schleiermacher really talks about the religious as being the thing that brings the scientific and the ethical together, that it's sort of the thing that stands over both of them.
I didn't think that he had subordinated knowledge and action to religion, rather that it was sort of an equal third realm.
Well, he talks in both ways. Maybe it's a matter of pointing to that phenomenological thing, that the primary experience is this one of feeling, And then as you sort of cognitively evaluate it, then you figure out, well, okay, is this particular experience going to turn into a knowledge experience or turn into a action directing or action experience? But there's something more primordial about the emotional religious one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I do think it's its own independent third thing, right? And that doesn't simply combine the practical, the theoretical.
But it doesn't simply combine them, but it does combine them. Because it is the thing that ultimately combines your whole life. It connects you with everything. It connects you with yourself.
Perhaps it's some way to mediate between the two. I'm just trying to conceptualize this somehow.
I guess it would have to, because it's not like, say, my empathic understanding of human nature, which enables me to appreciate my fellow man, one of the things he talks about, and realize my connectedness to my fellow man. It's a mediator. It doesn't make me physically one with other people. Mm-hmm. It doesn't make us coalesce into... I was going to say, it doesn't make us coalesce into spirit a la Hegel, but remembering Tom MacDonald's interpretation of spirit from the secondary literature he read in Hegel, like that's exactly what it does, is having this mediation is what spirit is all about. Having a way to communicate and develop a culture with others, like that's what spirit, according to Hegel, which is just one of those, you know, it's not something Hegel invented. It's just one of those notions that was floating around there that Schleiermacher is taking advantage of as well.
For me, I'm stuck with this very unsatisfying pie chart that's just, you know, here's a pie split up into thirds, and I can't believe that's what he was getting at, but I'm trying to figure out how one relates to the whole.
I like what he has to say about the connection of religion to morality. In fact, I have a quote here. This is from somewhere in the first speech. Just as little can morality be in need of religion. A weak, tempted heart must take refuge in the thought of a future world. But it is folly to make a distinction between this world and the next. Religious persons at least know only one. If the desire for happiness is foreign to morality, later happiness can be no more valid than earlier.
Nice.
And that sounds, again, very Nietzschean. Like, if you're a life denying, why would you be saying, oh, I can deny myself in this life because in heaven I'm going to have it good? There's just something crazy about that in terms of if you don't value pleasure and self-realization or whatever the kind of things that Nietzsche is going to say are good, or regular people would say are good, then why would you value them in the next life either? Whenever you sacrifice, well, what are you sacrificing for? There has to ultimately be something that is valuable in itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so why not make it here? Why not include at least this life as one of the things that is valuable? Maybe there is a life after that is also valuable.
No, you're right. I think in the second speech, he goes on to criticize people who sort of go through self-mortification and all of these sorts of pain-inducing self-disciplines, self-abnegation. That doesn't accomplish anything. It just makes you miserable. It doesn't bring you any closer to God. In that sense, it's a life-affirming, optimistic view of religion as it plays into human life, which is, if nothing else, aesthetically appealing. I'm not sure what persuasive value it has. You know, his mission here presumably was to get people to be religious. Does it accomplish that?
I think it worked with his friends, didn't it?
Was it one of the Schlegels? I think so.
Yeah. But again, I think the kind of persuasion here, it's not like you can be persuaded by argument. You're given a heads up about the existence of this type of experience or the feeling or intuition of involved in piety, right? And it's then something, I suppose, you... I don't know how you seek it out exactly, except maybe by, as Mark mentioned, going through the motions, sort of Saint Augustinian idea.
What is the Augustinian idea?
So a non-religious person, by going to church or participating in certain ceremonies, which I suppose would not be the way for Schleiermacher, but by doing certain things, could eventually their feelings would catch up with that faith would come. In this case, I'm not sure what you, suppose you're one of these completely skeptical, non-religious, cultured despisers. What's the next step that you would take based on this, you know?
Right.
Reading something like this, unless you might be better at knowing the pious experience when you have it and being able to locate it as something religious, and then maybe that blooms.
I guess I'm just trying to get a sense of, is there value to apologetics? I mean, the first speech translates alternately as defense or apologetics. I mean, that seemed to be his mission here. The Augustinian approach was interesting. It reminds me a lot of Blaise Pascal. It had a very similar approach toward trying to get people to understand religion based upon the concept of Pascal's wager, that you'll never really know the answer until you're dead about whether or not there's a God. And given that the cost of being a Christian is relatively low compared to the infinite reward that you could gain from being one, then if you're a betting person, that would seem to argue in favor of being a Christian. Now, I think that's the comic book version of Blaise Pascal's argument. But what I thought was more interesting was the second dimension that he introduced, which sounds very much like the Augustinian argument, which is, it's going to sound very cynical that you're believing in God for the hope of whatever rewards you could get in the afterlife. But here's what you got to do. You have to go to church, and you have to act like a Christian, and you have to go through the rituals, and you have to pray the various hymnals. And eventually what you'll find is that after time, you'll simply become Christian. You'll actually kind of drink the Kool-Aid, and you'll start to believe it all. What I'm just trying to tease out here is to maybe bring it back full circle. Is we had talked about apologetics, right? Even nowadays, people are responding to the new atheist by trying to come up with different forms of apologetics. And I sometimes wonder, without beating up on Schleiermacher or any one writer or thinker or philosopher, is there a role for apologetics? Is it doing anything other than just speaking to the converted?
For me, I happen to be someone who's both not religious. They call me an agnostic, although in a sense, you know, with regard to a personal God, I'm an atheist. I mean, whether you call me an atheist or agnostic is kind of up for grabs. But I find religious apologetics very interesting, and certainly I find arguments against the new atheists very interesting. One thing Schleiermacher mentions, it's a reference to Plato, is this. In Plato, it's called doxosophia, or conceit of wisdom, or you might call it knowingness, this sort of arrogant, all-knowing attitude towards these types of things, the close-mindedness that I think the new atheists exhibit to some extent. So what I think is important about apologetics is the preservation of the sense that the world is actually mysterious and we don't live with any final answers, whether they're religious or scientific. So the kind of religious experience that preserves the sort of Socratic, I know only that I'm ignorant, or that sort of incorporates the skeptical position, the kind of skeptical position that I like, that resonates with me. If anything, the belief, or if there's a place for faith or religious experience, it involves an acknowledgement of this mystery, let's say. And I think there are good apologists who do that. And I think Schleiermacher gets at that a little bit.
This is actually where he talks about how you can't be truly scientific without being pious as well, just as you can't be truly moral without being pious.
Mm.
Just as one cannot be truly scientific without being pious, the pious man may not know at all, but he cannot know falsely. His proper nature is not of that subordinate kind, which according to the old adage that like is only known to like, knows nothing except the semblance of reality. His nature is reality which knows reality, and where it encounters nothing, it does not suppose it sees something. And what a precious jewel of science, in my view, is ignorance for those who are captive to semblance.
Yeah, there we go.
If you have not learned it from my speeches or discovered it for yourselves, go and learn it from your Socrates. Grant me consistently, at least. With ignorance, your knowledge will ever be mixed. But the true and proper opposite of knowledge is presumption of knowledge.
Right. Presumption of knowledge is actually, when I saw that, I recognized that as his translation of this conceit of wisdom that's a big Platonic theme.
The most intriguing part of this to me was this very existential, I mean, I think before Kierkegaard, he's the first existentialist, maybe, I don't know, or Hegel, or Nietzsche. But anyway, these guys were all giving birth to existentialism. But the idea that because religion has its source in this individual experience, then religion is radically individualistic and so artistic. We are saying once you have piety, then you start seeing the world according to piety. But that's not just, it's not like everybody puts on the same rose-colored glasses. It's like you have your own very individual glasses, which is why it's important when you're trying to become more religious or learn more about religion to have lots of different teachers, because they all get at the infinite. And of course, they only get at one part of the infinite, one little root from a different way. And so the way that they will try to convey it to you will be using different images. And they see, and he points out very concrete things, like there are some people that see God in the beauty of nature. And there are some that see God in the workings of history. And these are two different classes of personalities, but they're both right, according to this. And again, that doesn't mean that because there's nature, therefore we can conclude that there is God, or because there's history, therefore we can conclude God is at work in history. No, that doesn't follow at all. But once you have these things, you can give these interpretations that somehow are supposed to artistically, in a very individual way, elaborate something important about God. So it's like you have the whole of this religious feeling and you can only express it through these parallels and comparisons, and they're always going to be kind of approximate. But because of that underlying unity of everything, they're always going to be, in a literal sense, exactly true as well, in a sense. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah, that's great. It reminded me of a section here, which I think supports exactly what you were saying. He says, within sort of the upper third of the second speech, "Were I to compare religion in this respect with anything, it would be with music, which indeed is otherwise closely connected with it. Music is one great whole. It is a special, a self-contained revelation of the world. Yet the music of each people is a whole by itself, which again is divided into different characteristic forms, till we come to the genius and style of the individual. Each actual instance of this inner revelation in the individual contains all of these unities. Yet while nothing is possible for a musician, except in and through the unity of the music of his people and the unity of music generally, he presents it in the charm of sound with all the pleasure and joyousness of boundless caprice, according as his life stirs in him and the world influences him. So, I mean, it touches upon one of the existential affects, which is how does one relate one's personality to the universe at large or to existence at large? And I think I shared with you guys some lecture notes that Heidegger had prepared on the second address from Schleiermacher, and he seemed very taken with it. He seemed very much approving of Schleiermacher's approach.
See partiallyexaminedlife.com for the blog post that Daniel will do about these Heidegger notes.
And I think he had concluded to the effect of religion, it's like a holy music. It's a way of doing. It's a way of acting. So in that sense, it's a nice vision.
I found another quote about the personal God issue that I think is worth bringing up, because, again, this is a big point of confusion. You know, is he a Spinozist, really? It's 27% into the book. I'm looking at my Kindle. The sum total of religion is to feel that in its highest unity, all that moves us in feeling is one. To feel that aught single and particular is only possible by means of this unity. To feel, that is to say, that our being and living is a being and living in and through God. But it is not necessary that the deity should be presented also as one distinct object. To many, this view is necessary, and to all, it is welcome. It is always hazardous and fruitful in difficulties. In other words, it brings a lot of difficulties. Not that it's fruitful in dealing with difficulties. It is not easy to avoid the appearance of making him susceptible to suffering like other objects. It is only one way of characterizing God, and from the difficulties of it, common speech will probably never rid itself. But to treat this objective conception of God just as if it were a perception, as if apart from his operation on us through the world, the existence of God before the world and outside of the world, though for the world were either by or in religion exhibited as science is, so far as religion is concerned, vain mythology. What is only a help for presentation is treated as a reality. It's a misunderstanding very easily made, but is quite outside the peculiar territory of religion.
The critical sentence there is, but it is not necessary that the deity should be presented as also one distinct object. And I see now why you were sort of rebutting what I was a little too quick to say, which is, well, there's really no personal God here. And what you're saying is, it's not that there's no personal or that there's a non-personal. It's that it's not really to be spoken of.
Right. It's outside the province of religion to make such a distinction.
Right.
Which is funny because that's what theological speculation seems to be all about.
So good. No, I'm happy to be corrected on that. That was very well put.
Closing thoughts. Have we already said everything?
I apologize for anyone who thought that Schleiermacher is really just sort of a relic of time. I do think that it has value for people's historical interest in Heidegger's later period, how he seemed to become more religious and take on an idiosyncratic religion. I could see how that would have been informed by Schleiermacher. I also just found it interesting reading him as one of the romantics. It works perhaps more as a piece of literature or as a piece of poetry than as a piece of philosophical argument, at least for me. And I would recommend that anyone who found any turns of phrase in this interesting, perhaps take a look at his own literary influences, Novalis or Hölderlin, and it may give you a better insight as to where he was coming from with his religion and, you know, see if it speaks to you at all.
Wes?
Yeah, I thought it was a good choice. I found it, difficult to get through. It's not a piece of philosophical reasoning, which is not necessarily bad, but even stylistically, and this is probably a matter of translation as well, I just found it very difficult, but I think these insights are important. I think they're floating around in that whole romantic tradition. I think I understand what's going on a little better in Hegel, for instance, just by getting some familiarity with this. And I was also, I really didn't know that this kind of liberal theology was a few hundred years old. I didn't know that someone as radical as Schleiermacher was doing his thing at this time. So very interesting.
Yeah. I know we're bunching up on the figures in this time period quite a lot, but I like the fact that when he's talking about the urges toward individuality versus subsuming the self to a larger whole, that sounded so much like the dynamics of self in Hegel, and this account of the divine as something that is sort of the first step that we run into before we individuate objects, that sounded so much like Schopenhauer, also an exact contemporary of Schleiermacher. So it was a kind of a familiar world, and it was interesting to see another little bit of it. And this translation is from 1893, so I'm sure somebody could come up with a better one. It's interesting that some of the individual passages were so poetic, but yet it never turned into a fast-flowing document in the way that Nietzsche's poetic speech does. I could just read Nietzsche all day, and this dude, like, oh, I was having a hard time getting from sentence to sentence on parts of it. Because it's so...
A lot of indefinite pronouns.
Yes. Maybe Schleiermacher needed a Walter Kaufman
exactly
to juice it up.
Is there a newer translation? This guy...
Probably.
Pruder?
Pruder, yeah.
Yeah.
We use the free one.
So. Right, that's the price you pay.
And with a very long intro by the translator in 1893, talking about why he's important historically as of 1893.
So right.
Kind of crazy.
Right. Quick trivial note. You had mentioned Schopenhauer was something of a contemporary of Schleiermacher. He was actually a student of Schleiermacher in 1811. So he had taken a class with Schleiermacher about 1 year after the University of Berlin was formed and was unimpressed, needless to say.
I can see that.
Yeah.
Yeah, the parallels with the modern day surely are amazing. And we will chase these down in some future episodes. Next time, we're going to be reading Plato's Republic, specifically books 1 through 5, really focusing on 1, 2, and 4. Please let us know what you thought of this. Participate on some discussion on this on partiallyexaminedlife.com. We will, if we are good, post a lot of helpful follow-up information for this and many other episodes. Go on iTunes Store, give us a good rating. Join us on Facebook. The Facebook group has been revamped by Facebook itself and is just that much more interactive and sends me a million emails a day. So it's actually quite overwhelming right now.
Yeah, I think I'm going to be unsubscribing to them.
No. Do go on the blog as well, partiallyexaminedlife.com. We're also on Twitter, or you can subscribe via email and have it sent to you on a daily basis or near daily basis that way. Please spread the word. Send this episode to your friends and family members, for instance. And have a good night.
Thanks a lot, you guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, Daniel. Good night.
Good night.
Light our lamp. Depression beat false yawn and lights and horse that find nothing in winter but ice and snow. But I'm thinking through these days, what had come will not go away. And I'm thinking through these days, what had come will not go away. Yeah. Not go away. Frosted glass and slow morning starts from condensed breath, murmured curses dart. First and tall and could they contemplate, they'd wonder what's unfolding, the ones I rate. But I'm thinking through these days, what had come will not go away. And I'm thinking through these days, what had come will not go away. Come and go away, like the sun setting our September day. We'll return and we stay with the dust we are and the dust we make. The dust we make. Days, what had come will not take.